is the Holy Spirit flame. We have a burning desire to lift up Jesus' name.
Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
Healing. Can y'all read that? Okay. And what's the first thing we talked about in healing? Healing is what? What is it? Come on, read. Healing is a redemptive truth. Okay? And it is found under the compound covenant name. Yahweh or Jehovah. And it's the hyphenated name of Rapha. Okay, Exodus 15:26 or 36. I forget right off. I don't have it in mind. Okay. So the first thing is healing is a redemptive truth. You get that from the covenant name. Remember, the all caps in your Bible. Yahweh or Jehovah, Rapha, and I'm the Lord that healeth thee. Okay. Let me look right up because I want to make sure I put the right scripture up there. All right. So the first thing we learned was that healing is a redemptive truth. What else is a redemptive truth? Salvation, being saved. Okay? Healing falls into the category of spiritual salvation. It is a redemptive truth in the same lines as that. And it is 26. Okay. I went and put that. I was right the first time. Okay. Exodus 15:26. Secondly, so this was the first thing we covered. That is a 15, Joe. Yeah, Exodus 15. 26. Then second, talk about that healing and salvation. And when we refer to it in this context, we're talking about spiritual, being saved. Or what? As Brother Hagin used to call it, God's double cure. And we talked about scriptures last week. We talked about how that, you know, Psalm 103, verses 1 through 4, 1 Peter 2:24, Isaiah 53, Matthew 8:17, all included healing and salvation. And then we talked about how that, that as John, remember we got into John last week. In 3 John 2, he prayed above all things that they would do what? Prosper. And do what? Be in health. In relation to what? As a soul prosperous. So it is according to soul prosperity. So this is just review. So we talked about how you renew your mind to the Word of God. And then when you renew your mind to the Word of God, you have God's view of things. John is equating. So what? John 3 John is God's view. Why? He's the disciple whom Jesus loved. Remember? Y'all remember that from last week? Okay. So we were talking about this along these lines. So we've covered that healing is a redemptive truth. Bozo. Sometimes you just do some bozo-y things. There. We're talking about healing, but healing is redemptive truth, and it's healing and salvation are God's double cure. So, Jesus bore our sickness and disease at the same time. That's why it's a redemptive truth. It is part of the plan of redemption. Okay? Okay? If we look at Ephesians chapter 1. Okay, in whom, verse 7, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins, hallelujah, according to the riches of his grace. And so here we have talking about redemption, and then we got, the fact that it is forgiveness of sin, but it also includes salvation. Hallelujah. And I was looking for that scripture. I thought it was right there, but it's not. Salvation of our bodies. And I don't have that. I don't have a working concordance really here to work with. So, hallelujah. Okay. So, we talked about, let's look at some scriptures. As we kind of got here, we got talking about John's view of things. It was God. Remember, John's view was whose? I'll just make this God's view. John's view, God, John's statement, we kind of just kind of laid it out. He was the disciple whom Jesus loved. He was the last apostle of the Lamb. He had been on the Isle of Patmos. He had had the vision of Jesus. And John writes to the church. And what he wants from the church is that for them to have prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospers. Remember, be not conformed to the world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. And that we have what? We end up with God's view of things. And God's view was of all the things that John could have been inspired by the Holy Ghost to say, you know, I pray above all things that you love your neighbor as you love yourself. Was love important? Absolutely. Okay? But he prayed that they would prosper and be in health, even as their soul prospered. And so I think it just equates to me that this subject right here is very important to God. If John took that much effort, it's important to God that we be healed. So that brings me to the point of, I have a hard time with people saying God's making you sick when he's so much emphasis for him to heal you. Okay? That the scripture places an emphasis on that. Okay? So, remember we said this, Jesus bore our sin at the same time that he bore our sicknesses. Bore our sicknesses and disease at the same time he bore our sins. Matthew 8, 16 and 17. We were just kind of picking up from here. So, Matthew 8, 16 and 17. And when evening was come, they brought unto him a man that were possessed with devils. He cast out the spirits with his word and healed all that were sick, that it might be fulfilled by what was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. So this is the parallel scripture to Isaiah 53, 3 through 5. And of course, the New Testament is 1 Peter 2:24. Okay? All right. Of course, and then we have here 1 Peter 2, whose own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree. What's that? Spiritual salvation. That we being dead to sin should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. Isaiah, he was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. We hid as it were our faces from him. He is despised and rejected of men. He was despised and we've seen him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, or he carried our sicknesses and bore our pains. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, or his wounds, as some translations would say, we are healed. Okay. So we have these scriptures here equating that healing and salvation go hand in hand. That, you know, being saved spiritually, being healed physically are together. And why do we say it's just as important to God? We know, we get insight into the fact that it's just as important to God. Why? Remember? It was what? The same what? Carrie. Say it out loud, Carrie. Sacrifice. It was the same sacrifice. Jesus. At the same time. Jesus was the same sacrifice that bore our what? Our sicknesses and bore our sin. God put our sins on Jesus and he carried our sicknesses at the same time. The same sacrifice. That sacrifice was used in different ways. He was one was redeeming man spiritually, the other was to redeem him physically. Okay? All right. Now, think about this now. If you know, God sees this all this way. And then he comes to the church in 1 Corinthians, I think 16, I think what it was. 6. 6. 19 and 20. Let me read this. That's an R. Okay. 1 Corinthians 6, 19 and 20. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost? which is in you, which you have of God, and ye are not your own, for you are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Think about this now. He comes along here and says what? That your body is whose? God's. Your body belongs to God. God, think. God says your body belongs to Him. And not only that, belonging to Him, it is the Holy Spirit's temple. What's that? Dwelling place. The Holy Spirit's dwelling place. God's not looking to make your body sick. God's not trying to put disease on you. It's His. And it's the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. It's where the Spirit of God dwells. He no longer dwells in the temple made by the hands of men. The veil was rent in twain from top to bottom, thus signifying that He would never dwell again in temples made by the hands of man. He came, so we now are His. Well, He wants what? He wants a pure vessel. Now, that's why we are to do the right things with the temple of the Holy Ghost. Know you not, like remember He says this, know you not he that is joined to the harlot is one flesh? Remember that? We're to watch what we do with our body, because why? It's the Holy Spirit's temple. Now, if God's requiring us to handle His body, it's His body, belongs to Him, with integrity, with uprightness, and out of sin, why is He going to come and put something on it to destroy it? Why? Because God is not the author of disease. As one person said, said that sickness is the stepchild of its evil parent, sin. Now, it doesn't mean that if you get sick, you've sinned. It's in the earth because of sin. What? Man was what? Man was triune. God's triune, man's triune in a different sense. That's probably not right. It may be what it is. I'm not sure. Man is spirit, soul, body. Okay? This is pneuma. I think. Okay, this is psuche. And this is soma. Yeah, pneumonia. Yes, right. Okay. Huh? Okay, how about pneuma? Man is spirit, soul, and body. When man was created, he was not sick. His body wasn't sick. Okay. There we go. That I knew something just didn't look right. Okay. Well, praise the Lord. Somebody just sent money. Somebody's having fun. They just figured out how to do it. They're just having fun with it. Hallelujah. Man, spirit, soul, and body. Man was created, what, in the image of God. His body was created from the dust of the ground. God breathed it into the breath of life. It wasn't sick until the fall of man's spirit. Okay? God did not dwell in a sick body in original creation. Original creation was perfection. Y'all going to help me out here, guys. Origin. Is it origin? That's right, original. Creation. Perfect. Well, how do you know? God saw that man was, the creation of man was, the original creation, it was perfect. God created man and saw that it was very good. Man's created in original creation, alive unto him, a soul. He, listen, he was not some caveman going, ogga, mugga, mugga. Woman. No. He named all the animals. He communed with God. His intelligence was, and the soul was able to commune and talk with God and fellowship with God. He was not some caveman out there trying to discover fire. Well, I'm the king of the jungle now. Jungle VIP. I've reached the top and had to stop, and that's what's bothering me. Want to be a man cub. Stroll right into town. How? Because he wanted to create fire, remember? Jungle Book. I'm tired of monkeying around. Oh, oopie. Okay, you know, anyway, man was created perfect. His body was whole. His body was designed to live forever. It wasn't until the fall that sickness was able to enter in. So, God came to redeem the whole thing. All of mankind. Spirit, soul, and body. Okay? Now, we've got man, same sacrifice for Jesus. Now our body is referred to as what? The temple of the Holy Ghost. You're not your own, you're God's. Your body is God's. God wants your body well. Now, we know according to Ephesians that we don't get the purchased possession. We're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. We don't get the redemption of our full redemption. What do you mean full redemption? The glorified body. Remember that Paul wrote to the church and said this, that the dead, that they'll come down from heaven, the dead in Christ shall rise. Amen. The dead, those which are alive remain, should not prevent those which are asleep, for the dead, they shall rise first, and they will be in the air. And it goes on and says this. It says that this corruption shall put on incorruption, this mortal shall put on immortality. We change in the moment, twinkling of an eye. We're going to get glorified bodies. That is the finality of the redemption of your body. But in the interim, God made provision for that body, although it was doomed to eventually die in waiting for Jesus to come back, to be whole and well. Now, you're going to stare at some of those Old Testament saints. Man, they'd call the family in. I'm dying today. You're blessed. You're cursed. You're cursed. You're blessed. Cursed. Blessed. 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 Cursed. Bye. Boom. Hello? The story is that Wigglesworth told his family, said, I'm going home today. They thought he was senile because he was 87. No. And he went, Papa, you're home. He didn't bother. You know, he went down the chair, got in his rocking chair, and went home. Hello? Lester Summerall preached his last sermon and said, the C-130 cargo plane's paid for. The ministry's paid for. The Evangeline cargo ship for, you remember his End Time Joseph program, Feed the Hungry, where he's feeding people all over the world. It's paid for. So I'll see you on the other side. That was and then he, a week later, he died. People say, well, he died, you know, he had some kind of infection. Listen, your body could do all kinds of things when you decide you're leaving. You can call it what you want to call it. Brother Hagin said this, and they said he said it for years. He said the best, he even preached it, the best way to die is to get up, have your favorite breakfast, your favorite dessert, and go home. And that's exactly what he did. He got up, Sister Horton was over there, Doc Horton's wife, and she made a strawberry cream pie he loved. And so they had breakfast, and he ate the strawberry cream pie. Said he looked over at Sister Aretha, smiled at her, and dropped his head. Now, the only reason he stayed in intensive care on life support for a few days was the rescue squad that got there was Raymagrads. And they worked on him for 45 minutes and kept zapping him and everything to keep him alive. They were going to keep Dad Hagin ain't dying on my watch. roommate stories there. They're going to keep him alive. But then you hear Pat and Pastor Hagin talk about it, Pat Harrison and Pastor talking about it. They'd come out and talk and said, He's not there. I know this. I've been around people who died that you know, a good friend of mine, Tommy Fields, he, I guess maybe been 10 years ago now, 8 years ago, maybe 8 years ago. I got a phone call from Bruce Black. Said, Ed, Tommy's over in the hospital in Winston-Salem, and, you know, it's not good. Said, you know, so I went over there, and, of course, our regional director was already there, but, of course, you know, Raymond didn't know I knew him. You know, they didn't, the office didn't know it because he wasn't in our district. He was out in West part of the state. He even helicoptered here. Went to the doctor's office. They said, you're going straight to Baptist. And Winston-Salem put him on a helicopter out of their doctor's office down there in Mercy and sent him straight up here. Put him on some kind of chemo because he had some kind of weird leukemia and had a reaction to it and it killed him. Well, they had him on life support. And so when I got there, you know, his wife knew me and the kids knew me because we were friends. And so I got to talk with him. So I went in to visit with him. I went in there and I called Brother Doug. I said, Doug, he ain't there. He said, well, see, which, how do you read it? I said, he's not there. I said, he's gone. I mean, you could tell. You're in the room and you know they're not there. They're just gone. What do you do? Well, how did that happen? Their spirit's alive unto God. Their body's not going to live forever. Okay? But your body can shut down on you when you leave. And all fluids fill up, all kinds of stuff happens when that happens. And so the doctors will come in and say, well, you know, because we got to put something on the report, he died from this. Well, you know. Man, when they pack up and leave, your body just gets, the body without the spirit's dead. I said, the body without the spirit's dead. You know, so he flew. And I've been around people who've done it. You know, you come into the room and they're not. I've gone in there and they were there. Barely. I said, barely. Some of y'all will remember Sister Herndon. Now, Sister Herndon, you know, she got so upset one time because I got to the hospital before she got her wig on. she wore this big old wig, you know, and she told me one day, she looked at me, she said, my husband was as white as you are. I didn't know that. My husband's white as you are. Okay, Sister Heard, I didn't know that. Hallelujah, because he had passed away some years before. But she had lapsed into we'd dealing with stuff, you know, with some things for a long time, and we tried, but she just couldn't quite get her over. You know, yeah, Pastor, I'm going to get better. Oh, Sister Hearn, you know, I love you, but you're going to have to get in the positive. You're going to have to get now. Yeah, I know it. Pat, Lord, one of these, you know, you almost got one of these days kind of things. Well, she had lapsed into a coma, really, and went to the hospital. And she's there. I walked in, she's there. You sense it. You know her spirit's there. So I talked to her. Now, she's out. She's not talking to me. Sister Hearn is pastor. And I talked to the family before I went in. And I said, y'all need to let her go. She's tired. She's tired of fighting this. And she had basically said that. She's tired of fighting with this and didn't want to fight it anymore. I said, y'all going to let her go. And they looked at, and the older daughter looked at me. She said, you're right. I know. That's what she wants. I said, okay. So I went in the room and I took her hand and said, Sister Herndon, it's pastor. I said, I come to tell you it's okay to go. I said, so you go ahead. The family's good. Everything's okay. You go ahead on. We'll see you on the other side. Why didn't you raise her up? You can't override their will. Their spirit is taking a higher place. Let go of her hand. Walked out of the room. I'm 20 feet down the hallway, and one of the daughters that was in the room came around, Pastor, she's gone. I mean, I hadn't gotten three rooms down the hallway. She's gone. Yep, I knew she was ready to go. Now, you know, it's amazing how much power your spirit has over your body. Amen? And keeping it here and functioning here. But once that spirit goes, there's nothing to keep the body alive. Amen. You can put artificial stuff on it. They can start pumping, you know, electricity into it to keep the heart, whatever. But you know, when they study the brain waves, there's nothing there. That's a lot of times they'll say, oh, there's no brain waves. Honey, why are you crying? Just talking about Sister Herndon? She was a sweet lady. Oh, she was a sweet lady. She was just so precious. She loved our family. She loved our kids. Hallelujah. And we've had that happen more than once. Hallelujah. Amen. But the body will do things at death that didn't kill it. That's what I'm trying to get to. The spirit left. And then they chalk it up to this, had a heart attack or whatever. Yeah, they got to put something on there. No, the spirit left. You know? Oh, my. Hallelujah. Did that with my grandfather. I couldn't get to the hospital. The family got there to see him awake. By the time I got there, he had lapsed back into he had had a stroke and been on Coumadin for 15 years. So it was, you know, it wouldn't stop. Go ahead. Take another. Here's a red one. And I got to the hospital. He was already back out. He wasn't. He never woke up. And they said, you know, they said, we don't know. He's whatever. And I went in. He was still there. I talked to him for a little while. I said, Granddaddy, I was holding on to you so I could come by and say goodbye. And said, you know, you go ahead. And I drove out to Greensboro and got a phone call. He went. But he was there when I got there. And of course, a couple of days before, the kids had been in there with him around his bed, and he couldn't talk, but he would just hold their hand and look at them, play with their fingers. My granddad was a little short man. He was like, he got shorter as he got older. He went from like 5'7" down to 5'5". He really did. He was hallelujah, praise the Lord. But our body is what? It's a temple. It's God's temple. It's the temple of the Holy Ghost. It houses your spirit. Amen. So when the spirit leaves, the body will do weird things. And I'm going to tell you something. The answer to everything is that they can't figure out what it was. You had a heart attack. Because the heart stopped. Well, duh. Of course it did. You died. Okay. When it comes with God and his plan of redemption, remember redemptive truths we've been talking about, you don't have to choose between the spirit and the body. You don't have to make a choice. You don't have to make a choice, well, I'm going to be spiritually strong, but I'm going to have to be weak physically. Now, what about that? That, renew your mind.
Yeah, that's it right there.
Renew your mind. Okay? Be not conformed to the world, but be you transformed by the renewing of the mind and the soul, the psuche. Yes. Amen? This is where the choice gets made most of the time, is in here. But you don't have to choose between being well and sound physically and well and sound spiritually. Why? Because God paid the price. God wants your spirit sound. But you're in a dwelling place of God's spirit, so he wants that body sound too. Amen? Hallelujah. So it's as much God's will to be well. I'm sorry. It's as much God's will for us to be well as it is for us to be saved. Jesus came down to do God's, the will of the Father. And in John 6:38, what does he say in John 6:38? I came down not from heaven to do my will, but the will of him that sent me. Now, and remember, Jesus told Philip, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. The works that I do, the Father doeth them, you know, that he doeth them in me. I'm not doing them of myself. And so we have Jesus being the representative. Hebrews says it's something very interesting. I love the way Hebrews says this in Hebrews 1. And of course, it would be better if I got to Hebrews 1 and got out of the book of Acts. Book of Acts is a great book. But it's not what we're talking about here. Okay? Hebrews 1, and we can go verses 1 through 3, okay? It says here, God who in sundry times and in divers manners spake unto the past by the prophets, unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. What do you mean he spoke to us? What? He spoke to us. remember what John's gospel says in John 1:1? In the beginning was the Logos in the Greek. In the beginning was the Logos, the Word, the full embodiment, the full discourse. Jesus was the full discourse. In the beginning was the Logos, the full discourse. And the Logos was God. Hath in these last days spoke to us. How? By His Son. Okay? Whom He appointed heir of all things, by whom He made all the worlds. Who being the brightness of His glory, and what? The express image of what? His person. Jesus was the express image of God's person. He's the Word. He is the full. Logos has more of a meaning of the full discourse. Okay. That's beautiful E over there. Okay. Jesus is the full disclosure, the full discourse of God. And Jesus, God, through the express image of His person, spoke to us in these last days. Through who? Jesus. What does, now, how did He speak to us? I came down not to do my will, but the will of Him that sent me. He, Philip, that has seen me, has seen the Father. What did Jesus do? He went round about their villages teaching in their synagogues. Actually, it says, preaching the gospel of the kingdom. Teaching in the synagogues and healing. Healing all. Now, wait a second. If God has spoke to us through Jesus, and Jesus went about preaching, teaching, and healing, and Jesus said in John 6:38, came not to do my will, but the will of Him that sent me, came not to do my will, but the will of Him that sent me. And God spoke to us. He spoke to us through the very express image of His own person. That was Jesus. Because in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. The Logos of God. This is our Greek word, Logos. Greek. Okay? And He was God. So we have Jesus say, I didn't come and do my will. I did the will of Him that sent me. Philip, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And then God says, in the testimony in the book of Hebrews, He comes and says this. He says that He spoke to us through the express image of His person. That was Jesus. And what did Jesus do in His ministry? He went round about preaching the gospel of the kingdom, teaching in their synagogues, and healing all. Healing all. So if we back this up, then God wants people well. Because Jesus is His expressed image. He is. Remember, we can't look on God and live. We can't look at God in this state on His spiritual being. Remember, He took Moses and hit him in the cleft of the rock and said, you can only see my hinder parts. And that was so much that when He came down out of the mount, they had to put a veil on His face because the glory soaked into His skin. They couldn't look at Him. Oh, my. But God says, there's something else in John 1. Where's John 1? What are Did I put John? Yeah, John 1. Verse 14. And the Word was made flesh. And what did the Word and did what? Dwelt. Literally. In the Greek. Tabernacled. This is the Word that God was made, the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory as the only begotten of the Father. The word dwelt comes from a Greek word that literally means tabernacled. Or some translations put it this way, tented. God didn't want to dwell in a tabernacle made by the hands of men. He wanted to dwell in man. And we beheld His glory as the only begotten of the Father. Jesus came down and God put Himself in a body where He could walk in humanity. See, before, in the tabernacle, in Solomon's temple, where's God? He's in the Holy of Holies. Where are the people? Without the gate. They're outsiders. They can't come in contact with God. The only one that gets in there is once a year, and that's the high priest. The people are without, the key James uses the phrase, without the gate. They're outside. They can't come in contact with God. See, God's dwelling place here. Old Testament. But now Jesus comes. Jesus comes, New Testament, and dwells in a body. And what does He do when He is loosed from this temple of being held inside the temple, Holy of Holies, and the people are all outside the gate? What does God do when He gets into a flesh and blood body and He dwells tabernacles among the people? What does He do in that state? He preaches, teaches, and heals. When He can get in contact with His creation, when He can touch them, He administers healing power to their bodies. He could have wiped them out. But no. He gets out of that place, gets into the body of Jesus. He is God. He is God manifest in the flesh. He's dwelling, tabernacling, tenting among the people. And when He gets to them, everywhere He's going, He's healing. He's casting out devils. He's raising the dead. He's bringing deliverance and freedom to humanity. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. So we go back to what we talked about earlier, John's view. John having the view of God, remember? The Yahweh, Jehovah, Rapha, it's a redemptive reality. Healing and salvation go hand in hand. Jesus comes as the full discourse of God. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. Hebrews 1, He was the express image of His person. He is the full discourse. He is the express image of His person. And Jesus says in John 6:38, if you see, I came not to do my will, but the will of Him that sent me. And so now that he's not in Solomon's temple, He's out among the people, He's now coming to preach the gospel of the kingdom, teaching in the synagogues and healing all. Teaching, preaching, and healing. Are you getting blessed, Penny? Think of Jesus. Here He is. I'm God in the flesh. When I get in contact with you, healing power comes. Deliver. It's just right. Do you remember when they were at Peter's house? Do y'all remember that? there was a day that, you know, they were there, and lawyers and doctors of the law from every town round about were there to hear what Jesus had to say. And what was there? When they were at Peter's house, and the power of the Lord was present to do what? Heal them. None of them got healed because of their unbelief. The only guy that got healed was, they showed up, the house was full, they couldn't get in, they had a guy on a stretcher, they climbed up on the roof, tore the tiles off, and dropped him down in the middle, and Jesus said, you know, he said, thy faith has made thee, I mean, he said, your sins are forgiven you. The word, they got mad. Who can forgive sins but God alone? That you may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins? He saith unto, here's another point, he saith unto the sick of the palsy, rise, take up your bed and walk. What does that go back to? What does it go back to? Where is it? Oh. Jesus said, I'm going to prove to you I got the power to forgive sins and heal somebody. Woo! Glory to God! Same sacrifice. Same sacrifice. Which is easier, he said. Thy sins be forgiven thee, or take up your bed and walk. But then you may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins. He saith, take up your bed and walk. I don't make a Pentecostal out of a Baptist. Amen. It'll melt the ice off the Presbyterians. Are you here? Glory to God. Anybody gotten blessed? Hallelujah. So here we go. There it is. Redemptive truth. Healing and salvation are the same. Jesus is the what? The express image of his person. Hebrews 1:3 says. Express image of his person. He is an absolute reflection of who the Father is. Yeah, but that was when he was on the earth. Yeah, and that's why God just took the time. Put that in the Bible. I'm sorry. That's not it. Sorry, I just put the wrong scripture up there. But I was making such a good point. I was just rolling a roll too. Sorry. Put that in the Bible. Hebrews 13:8. That was only when he was here. Nah, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and that forever. Well, who was that? Well, he's the same one who is the express image of his person today as he was yesterday. He's the same one who is the full discourse, the Logos of God. He is the full discourse. He is the Logos of God. He is the same full discourse of the God as he was in the past, and he will be in the future, because he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Okay, and he's the same that dwelt among them, tabernacle, tented, and he came over. And what does he commission his body to do? Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them. Last chapter, Mark. In my name. Because he's the same. His body is carrying out the sameness of Jesus in the earth today that Jesus did yesterday. The works that I do shall ye do, and greater than these Now, I really don't, I honestly don't think he's talking about greater in quality, but greater in quantity. Okay? Okay? Because, and the one thing we do get to do that he wasn't doing when he was on the earth was actually getting people born again. He had to go sit down at the right hand of the Father and commission the church to go preach it, and they'd be saved. Okay? But, you know, his ministry was preaching, teaching, and healing. And he did that as the express image of the person that God was speaking to the world. Speaking through the world. Through the one who was the express image of his person. He spoke to us through the ministry of Jesus. And what did he speak to us? His will. That's an S. H-I-S. John 6:38. Not my will, but the will of him that sent me. He spoke to the world through Jesus. And what he was speaking was his will. And so the express image of his person, the full discourse of his will, when he dwelt among us and tabernacled in humanity in a body and could come in contact with them, preached, taught, and healed. And then commissioned the church the same. Because why? As the head of the church, he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The commission was what? What was really, think about this. What is the commission of God? Well, go on. No. What is the commission? It is to speak to the world who God is. Our commission is to be, remember he spoke, or he today he is speaking to the world. He spoke in time past. He is speaking to the world today through the church. His will, who he is. He's the same. So it's preaching, teaching, healing. We are the voice of God in the earth. And I'm not here to do my will, but the will of him that sent me. As my Father sent me, so send I you, Jesus said. In the same manner, with the same commission, to be the revelation of who God is while we are tabernacling, we're the temple of the Holy Ghost in the earth, and in this body we now preach, teach, and heal. Yeah, that's what I say, glory. Penny's like, glory. It's going all over me. Hallelujah. Well, did y'all get anything out of this? Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I didn't know I was a marker board teacher until 3 weeks ago. Hallelujah. Is this helping? Tying stuff together? Hallelujah.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fbc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.